That's better. Hopefully everyone can see me and the screen up there. And minimize a couple things and we'll get started. Well, welcome. Thanks for joining us today. This is Jeff Lake of Ellison Technologies. And the seminar, the webinar we're doing is there a cobot in my future? So that's a interesting slide. I'm just going to move a couple things around here. Jeff Lakes is essential. So this is a good friend of mine, Dave Fisher at S&H Machine down in Southern California. And for the last 5 weeks, I've been hosting a CV19 weekly call. I call it Made in America. Myself, I'm from the job shop industry. I've been in the industry for over 40 years running two job shops. So I'm very familiar with not CV19, but of course, business, the voice of the customer, the voice of your customer, dealing with the challenges that we've gone through today and we've gone through in September 11th, that we've gone through with, of course, the recession in 2009, 2010. So I've got a unique background. I joined Ellison 2 years ago, and I clearly understand the ins and outs of running a machine shop, a manufacturing company, dealing with customers, employees. And I thought it would be a good time to get together with friends in industry, have a weekly call and kind of share, hey, what are we doing? And that's what we're gonna do today. We're gonna kind of walk through cobots, break them down a little bit. Obviously, we just have a half an hour here, so we can only cover so much, but there's plenty of content available. We can certainly help out whoever likes if you guys wanna reach out and follow up. So with that, we'll go ahead and a little housecleaning and keeping, and then we'll get started here. So we're going to have a couple of polling questions during the process here, and I'll show you on your screen. That's how you answer your polling, you post your question. So there should be one coming up right now. We're going to do about three of those during the call today, and that just allows us to kind of get some insight. And also, we're going to share that with you guys as we move forward with the process. So I see the poll is opened. And it'll be open for just a moment. And then we'll look at the results and then we can talk about that and just discuss how that kind of feeds into what we're looking at today. And we'll just give it a second, close the poll in a moment, and then we'll resume. Okay, I'm a little bit blind on my side to the polling for some reason, but I believe the first question was, are you using OEE within your organization? And I'm getting the results texted to me right now. So 26% yes, use OEE or machine monitoring. 68% do not, and 6% plan to. And the reason I wanted to start with that question, and tie it into, is there a cobot in my future? Is a lot of times when people are looking at cobots or if they're looking at types of automation, clearly the reason they're doing it is productivity. When we start to look at automation and productivity, we also look at process control, and we'll touch on that a little bit. So it's always good to have a foundational baseline. You know, so I might think that I'm, you know, world class 85%, but if I look around my shop, I've got a lot of verticals perhaps, or two axis lathes where the doors are open, and when the doors are open, we're not cutting chips. So understanding, you know, plan, do, study, act. If we start off with machine monitoring, we have a baseline. If we start to implement change, we can start to see how that change affects us. Sound good? Okay, with that, we'll move on. Today, we're going to cover the cobot, just a little bit about what is a cobot, how can a cobot help my organization. We'll look at typical applications that are available for cobots. We'll talk a bit about how does it all work, how do we connect a cobot up to the machine, what's required, what concerns should I have? That's definitely a very important one when driving automation or change. And then we'll look at some real life application solutions. So cobot or collaborative robot is short. And really, you know, the whole idea behind a collaborative robot is we've got something that can work together with man and machine and be part of a cell. And we'll kind of dig into that a little bit. If you look up there, you can kind of see the version of an industrial robot. And they're different, right? So cobots work well together with people. We've got safety functions built in. There's certainly a level of ease of use. I remember when I installed my first cobot a number of years ago, we needed to make a simple change. And we didn't program it. We didn't set it up. We didn't understand it. So we literally had to contact a supplier, had to write a purchase order to get them out to do 2 hours worth of programming, travel time, get a quote, and write to PO, right? With a cobot, we're seeing many people are able to just pick it up in a matter of a couple of hours and to get it to complex levels in just a matter of weeks. So we've got another number of customers that just literally buy the cobot and take it on their own and work with it, right? So ease of use, flexible, movable, and fast to deploy and redeploy, right? So that's another big thing that means that sometimes we look at buying a machine tool or an accessory or automation device, and we're concerned that if I spend this money, if this slows down, if this market slows down, if this job slows down, can I still use it, right? And I think that's one of the great things about the cobot. It's actually easy to deploy and redeploy and move it through your shop even during the day. So different than industrial robots. So this is a great visual. If we look on the left side there, we can see a Fanuc robot, yellow robot, nothing wrong with Fanuc. They're great. We've sold them for many, many years. We continue to put them in companies on a regular basis. But you can also see this is probably a high production job. It's locked down. It's behind the cage. It's most likely script programming. And then we look on the right and we see a collaborative robot space, right? So we see the person working together with the cobot. And this is even the same at the Doosan factory. So if you were to visit the Doosan factory, you'd see on the job station, there's two cobots on the outer side. There's an operator in the middle. So he might go over and manage the wire loom. It's kind of a dexterous process, push it through there. After that, the cobot takes over, picks up a cover, drops it in, puts the screws in, torques all four screws, shows all four are tightened. We've got a record of that. And the operator is able to be more productive, right? And if you think about it, in your shop, if you've got maybe some talented people that are out setting up the machine, that's where they can take off. They can set up the machine, put the cobot in place, let it run, move out of the way, and let the cobot continue from there. So the other unique thing about the cobots is we don't have fences, but we do have virtual fences, workspaces, we call them. So if you look here, there's a few things involved with the cobot that's different from an industrial robot. Number one is we have a torque sensor. And unique to Doosan, we have a torque sensor at all six joints, so J1 through J6. And each one of those has adjustable sensitivity. We also have variable zones. So we can take, if we look down here, we've got a collaborative workspace where the cobot and the person are working together. We have a protected zone. So maybe we've got an area where we're using liquid nitrogen or something else, and the cobot's gonna be in that area, but it's not gonna go beyond that. We have a tool orientation restricted zone. So this would be a zone where maybe the cobot needs to, you know, orient or move something around, and it's outside the operator area. And then we have a selective collision detecting zone. So basically that's just a barrier that says, I don't want my cobot, even though it has reach to go beyond this area, I don't want it to go into the aisle. I didn't want it to go towards this area. I don't want it to go towards this other operator. And this is all fairly straightforward, intuitive things that we can put together in just a couple of minutes using the cobot and the touchpad, or even the cockpit that's located on the cobot. So ease of use. I mean, that is definitely one of the big features that we enjoy with a cobot. So from programming, from manipulating, we can kind of see to the side here from programming side. So there's actually the touch pendant. It looks a lot like a tablet or an iPad. We can see the icon-based wizard for training, for teaching. So basically we can set up a cell. I think in that picture there, it's showing a machine tending cell. We identify what cobot we have, what gripper we have, what we're going to do, and all those components are all built in place. So with a little bit of experience, you can basically write a whole program to run a job in about an hour. It's very quick. A couple of months ago up in Northern California, we got our team together there, the sales team. We spent about 4 hours there. At the end of the day, each one of them took a personal video. They showed their customers how they could do pick and place, how they could manipulate the cobot. So it's far, far different from the stigma attached to industrial robots where I have to hire somebody to come in and take care of it. And as I talked about before, it's very movable and it's quick to deploy or set up or move to another operation. One of the gentlemen we were talking to recently that purchased cobots from us not too long ago said that on average for him to switch over is about 15 minutes and to write a complete new program is about 1 hour. And that's just one of our customers who uses the cobot on a daily basis. And actually, they bought two and they're getting ready for their third one now. So, you know, in concert with what we first asked about OEE, how can a cobot help my organization? It kind of becomes a bit of a burning platform. So it improves utilization and it might drive process control improvements because it's going to run lights out. It's going to continue to run during break, during lunch. It's not looking for vacation pay. It's not going to have repetitive motion injury. And that doesn't mean we're trying to get rid of the people. We're just trying to free people up so we can improve span of control so your operators can be more valuable. They can learn, they can make more money, and you can have a better bottom line because your machines are running and you've got OEE going. And when we talk about systemic change, it means that, for example, if you've got a process that's got four MOs in it, maybe because you've got a chip control problem, or maybe you need tapping fluid on a certain hole. These are things that we're driven to fix because obviously we can't really run autonomously if we've got to stop throughout the process, right? So it does drive process improvement. And the OEE side is just a great way to overall look at what's going on in the organization and measure the improvement that's taking place. The ROI is kind of sometimes a misnomer because people might look and say, okay, just for example's sake, I've got an operator, I'm going to free him up, I pay him 50 grand a year, he's going to be able to do the job of 2.5 or 3 people. But I look at it a little differently because if we look and say, well, for example, I run, let's say, an 8-hour day and I don't work overtime, and perhaps that might be the case today with CB19, maybe that's your standard practice. Or maybe you run a 10-hour shift and there's 2 hours before night shift comes in. So that cobot is not only going to run during lunch and breaks, but it's also going to run in these in-between times. And in many cases, we've got customers identifying perhaps a weekend and what they want for lights out operation over the weekend. So anytime we start looking at automated runs on lights out, it is an area where we want to get our engineering team involved so we can be successful and really do some great things with our organizations. Some of the examples, there's quite a few, and this is just a handful of them right here. So machine tending, obviously a very popular one in our industry. Overall, machine tending is only about 25% of the utilization of cobots worldwide. The Doosan cobot came out of South Korea. That's where Doosan's located, right by the machine tool plant. And South Korea is one of the highest per capita users of cobots and robots worldwide. So it was a great place for them to get started, to get going. And we've seen a lot of different applications. So pick and place is very popular. And again, that's something we can do quickly. Air blow, maybe we've got an air blow process where we don't want to have the operator work on that. Assembling screws and gears. And this is a great thing about the Doosan cobot is on an assembly process, we have, you know, as I mentioned, 6 joints of safety, but that also gives us compliance and force control. So on a planetary gear, for example, that's a really common demo we do because it's so great. We can remove the center gear. We We can rotate it around so it's not going to be aligned, and then go push it down and we'll start to feel resistance. That's what we want. We're feeling force. And now we can start to rotate back and forth for compliance, get the mesh of the gears and install the gear assembly. And that would be the same like in your lathe, right? So let's say you've got variation in the raw material length. An operator is going to feel it, push it back in the chuck, lock it in, clamp and go, right? A cobot or a robot is going to stop at a certain point every time. But what we can do is we can go ahead and engage force control and say, continue to feed until you feel resistance. When you feel X amount of resistance, lock the chuck, and we can send that signal to the machine tool. Polishing and deburring is another great one we can do very well with, because we can accommodate the force and maintain the same force across the curved surface. Gluing and bonding is one that's very popular. Plastic injection assistance is very similar to machine tending. And then packaging, palletizing, press forming, similar to a machine tending operation. Inspection. And the interesting thing about inspection and a number of these things, right, is we might have inside our machine tool a process that runs 10 minutes and maybe the load and unload like takes 2 minutes. So we have 8 minutes of available time. And that might be a good time to maybe wash apart, to burr apart, and clean apart. Welding, torch, you know, those type of applications are also very popular. And then service is one that's on the Doosan website. They've got Robot Chicken in Korea. And in Las Vegas at the CES show this year, we were pouring lattes and coffees. So how does it all work? When we start to put an application together, first we want to talk about, okay, what's our goal? What are we trying to achieve here? We want to, let's say in this case, load and unload a machine, right? So first we're going to select the cobot. And in order to do that, we want to know a little bit more, not so much about the price, right, but the payload and the reach. So depending on our machine, we may use the smallest and the least expensive cobot on a screw machine or something like that. And then as we get into bigger machines, we have a bigger reach and payload requirements, right? So once we've satisfied, okay, this is the cobot we're going to use, then we're going to start to understand what's the end of arm tool, EOAT, end of arm tool, gripper, fingers, this is what we're talking about here. And we're going to determine, okay, how are we going to hold this part? And then we'll look at communication. So the cobot needs to be able to communicate with the device that it's working with. The Doosan cobot comes with 16 IOs, so we have 16 inputs, 16 outputs, where we can fire or receive signals and do things, actuate things, right? So the hard wire is the standard way that most cobots around the world are connected up. We run a wire from the IO into a certain place on the machine, whether that's a relay or a signal. The other way would be a gateway. So if we were working with something that maybe didn't have CNC logic, we can put a gateway in place or a PLC in place. And then, of course, with machine tools, we can also use an Ethernet IP. So if you're on a FANUC control, FANUC makes an Ethernet IP, but most machine tool builders have Ethernet IPs. And along with that decision, the decision of auto door is also optional. You know, so there's no right or wrong choice. It really depends on what the customer, you know, what good looks like to them. We've got a number of customers that use auto doors and a number of customers that have the cobot open and close the door. Which is kind of interesting. How does a cobot open and close a door if it's got force sensing and it's supposed to be safe, right? Well, it's really simple. When we go up to approach the door, we lock in the joints necessary, we push the door open, and as we start to release, we unlock the joints and back to safe mode. And then finally, cycle time, I touched on that briefly, is definitely a thing we want to consider, because when we start to look up and down the value stream, we might find that we can combine operations, reduce an operation, which of course points to work in process inventory and lets us just be more efficient overall. So if we've got, again, a 5 minute cycle time or 10 minute cycle time and only 1 or 2 minutes of loading, we might be able to deburr something on the part. There's plenty of room for the cobot to move around. And then maybe clean the part. So we've got some areas where we clean the part and possibly inspect as well. So we always want to look up and down the value stream to see what other things we can bundle into that process. So what concerns should I have? And I speak from experience here. I know many years ago working together with a team at B&B Manufacturing where I put together a cell. We all went to a class for learning. To see, right? So the classic lean classes back in the 90s and 80s. And we came back, we were super excited. We put this cell in place and then we said, here you go, guys, run it. And it failed miserably. And I don't know if you guys have seen the chain cycle. I've definitely incorporated into a lot of the training that I do, because it's really important, especially when we come and announce or we let people know that, hey, we're going to bring automation or a robot in, sometimes the concern is I'm going to lose my job. So trying to make sure that we communicate with the team, that we let them know in advance what we're doing, and that we find those champions that really want to help us succeed, because I've seen it in my own company and I've seen it in other companies, and Henry Ford said it well, whether I think I can or I think I can't, I'm right. And any company that thinks they cannot do this or has team members on board to say it's not going to work, they'll win, right? So we got to make sure this is an important part of preparation and planning and making sure that we do the right thing so we can be very successful with this. And as I mentioned earlier, many, many of the companies that we work with, after they install one cobot, they're looking at their second and shortly thereafter looking at additional ones beyond that. The other thing we talked about before too is process control, right? So unstable process, variation in process. These are things that all tie into, you know, an engineered process. I've done a number of seminars on I4.0 and how we bring that all back to the machine. And these are things we need to look at now. So if, let's say your team sits down and says, okay, let's do this. We're going to put it over on that machine over there. It's a multi-axis lathe. One of the first questions you might ask is, what's that process look like today? What does the operator get involved in? What kind of intervention is there? Are there MOs? What's the quality of the part, right? These are all things that we want to look at in advance so we can have a very successful implementation. And really, these are things that, you know, you, the customer, needs to take care of so you can be successful with this. So we have a second polling question, and I believe that's coming up now. So I'm going to take a look here. Thanks again for your participation today. Thanks for the polling. Hopefully you guys are learning some interesting things and learning a little insight on how others plan to look at things as well. So let's see, I'm looking at the question here. How many shifts do you currently operate? The poll's still open. One shift, two shifts, three shifts, planning to add a second shift, had a second shift in the past. And that's kind of an interesting one, especially with CB19 right now. We have seen a bit of a surge in cobots and automation. We've seen where customers were maybe thinking about something a couple months ago. They got kind of through this first couple weeks of cobots, starting to figure out how it works, and now realizing that maybe, hey, you know what, we have demand in this product line. We want to be more efficient with it. We want to be more productive with it, and that's where we'll install some automation. Okay, so... just waiting for the results. Appreciate your patience. Okay, well, I'm not seeing the results there. I apologize. Here they come now. Okay, appreciate your patience. It's kind of interesting, 39% have a single shift. That's one of the areas we see the biggest gains, and you'll see it in a couple of the videos we've got where people talk about, you know, maybe a job going from 9 days of production to four, and it's not because they don't have a cycle time that increased so dramatically, it's because the machine never stopped, and maybe they didn't have enough people in the company to keep the machine running. So 39% have one shift. 32% have two shifts, 21% have three shifts, 5% are planning on adding a third shift, and 3% basically had a second shift and no longer have one. So again, I think the takeaway there is, you know, where you don't have a shift or maybe a lack in shifts, you can just continue. Okay, so now we're going to dig into some actual automation solutions that we've seen that we put in place, that our customers have put in place. This first one is actually at our showroom in Charlotte. This is one of the first ones we did. So we shipped this cobot to the Charlotte team. They had no training. They're sharp guys, just like people in your organization. They read the manual. I called them up to see how they were doing, and they sent me this video. So they created the little nylon placard on top of the machine, the pallet, if you will, there. They're loading and unloading drink coasters, and we engraved those. Perhaps you guys have been one to our shows and picked up a drink coaster. But very simple operation, hardwired to the machine. You can see the wire going back to the machine. In this case, that wire would carry some leads to signals, and also a relay to open and close the pneumatic vise. I think in this case, it's a shunk vise, but there's a number of good vises out there. We also see in this case, we're using, that's where the force control will get locked in to close the door. And then, you know, once we get the interlock, then we'll go ahead, cycle start, we'll send a signal machine, cycle start, and then we'll come back away from the machine.
Hey, Jeff. Jeff, we lost your screen, your presentation.
Okay.
There we go. We're good.
Okay. All right. So I apologize for that. Apparently we missed one screen there. Make sure we got it back on track here. So so in this case here, we're looking at an oil field operation. So this is a stainless steel part. I think it's about 8 pounds. We've got a twin turret lathe up there, a Doosan TT1800, I believe. The customer wanted a weekend's run. So we designed a table around that, that based on his cycle time, give him enough room to run all weekend long. He literally ran this for a couple of weeks and then wanted to go ahead and pursue a second cobot machine. Being in the oil industry, I'm wishing all the best for that gentleman today. And of course, we've all got some interesting times. So that goes to everyone out there. Here's another one. This is kind of a really cool one. This is one of our customers out in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And they kind of wanted to do it together, but they wanted to take the lead. The gentleman that set this up actually built and designed his own gripper, that vacuum gripper. He's using Pearson work holding here. So he's got a zero point there, drops it down, and there's four parts on each pallet. So think about this. You guys probably have a vertical somewhere in your shop. Maybe you don't, but most do. They got a vise on there. They load the part, maybe one or two, close the door, press cycle start. Now the operator, hopefully he's got enough time to go do something else. In this case now, there's eight parts loaded on the machine. They've got eight parts worth of cycle time that are gonna run and give the operator that freedom. So again, it's not about getting rid of that person. It's about allowing him now to go over to another machine and set up another job and maybe deploy another cobot, go to inspection, or just handle other tasks that are far more important than loading and unloading a part. This was a simple demonstration we did at a recent open house, just showing that it doesn't have to be a machine tool. It could be a laser. It could be a grinder in this case, part marking. There's just so many different applications. This was another great one. This is a good friend of ours at W Machine out in San Fernando Valley in Southern California. They purchased a cobot. They sent their application engineer out to the training. He did 3 days of training, and they did this process on themselves. So they asked us a couple questions, but they incorporated, in this case, we have an air vise there. So it's an economical vise. It's actuated. It's a great tool, very popular out there. They had a person basically loading a dot peen and spending hours in front of the dot peen. So now inside the company, they've got somebody else running a machine, load up the parts and push the button, away you go. And they're getting ready to start their next implementation, which will be loading and unloading, I believe, a vertical machining center. This is another interesting one where a customer had a high production job or higher production job. Machining. They were looking at maybe three machines, possibly more, to meet the demand. And we pitched a thought that, hey, perhaps we can use a seventh axis and a range extender that allow one cobot to service two machines. So in this case, instead of having, you know, multiple machines and operators, we have two machines and one cobot traveling back and forth. And there's our application engineer, Russ Henthorpe, in Los Angeles, finalizing the turnkey. And we can see the application team working on the manipulation of parts. There's, I believe, 36 stations on the left, 36 on the right. The robot rail extender's behind us there. And then there's a machine on each side, two DBF 5000s. But the great opportunity here too is on the other side, that's all available space and time. So if you've got, I think, roughly a half an hour cycle time, you've got plenty of time to inspect, deburr, clean, and do other things. So great application there. This is another good one, dueling cobots, screw machines. So if you look in the background there in the far back, that's the first one this gentleman bought. And this isn't the same person I talked about earlier. This is another customer. This one's in Southern California. He thought about it for some time. He did his research. He finally purchased the first one. And his throughput went from 9 days to 4 days. Number two is the one to the front of the screen, and now number three is on the way. So definitely, you know, seeing customers find the value there. In this case, the customer definitely worked with us hand in hand while we managed the technical side, the connection side, but they very quickly become experts in their own class with cobots. So part management, I'll show you a little bit about. I know we're running a little bit over, so we'll kind of push it along here. I want to show you a few different examples of how we can hold parts beyond the standard base. This is one I posted on LinkedIn, I think about a week ago or so. This is a system we designed together with Vention. They're up in Canada, great company, great partner, and great for automation. We actually have a three-door version of this coming out to our Houston office this week. And we've got some other applications we're working. So in this case, there's two things going on. I have multiple drawers. I can just machine a nylon plate, drop them in there to hold whatever part I like. But up here, I'm also using a double end of arm tool. This particular one's from OnRobot. There's many good ones out there. But what it allows me to do is manipulate different parts, right? They're also available through Shang, through EMI, through, you know, OnRobot, quick change. So those tools right there, I can literally change them out in a matter of about 30 seconds. So if you start to think about how easy these are to redeploy, I can take the end of arm tooling off, change out a plastic pallet, do that in 5 minutes. As long as my work holding's in the same place, I'm going to be able to go right into production in just a matter of minutes. These are some other solutions. This is the one you just saw here when we worked on it virtually. This is one on the right side that's coming into our office for testing here in the next week or so. Everything's incorporated. So, of course, this is more of a stationary base, but it could be moved around. We've got the parts up on an angled rack, and we certainly have space to do secondary operations as well. To the left, there's a better picture of the pallet that was built on top of the base. And on the right side, we see Easy Robotics. They've got several versions. We're a partner with them. This particular one, the cart pulls out, you put another cart in, right? So there's a design and size for every amount of production that's out there. This is a customer out in Charlotte, and they used aluminum pallets, and they did a really great job. I think in this case, there's a Morisiki in one picture, a Dusa in the other. They used counterbores inside counterbores, so that way they can have multiple parts all set up and ready to go and just do a quick change, call it, and they're set to go for the next job. This is on the left, the one we just looked at. On the right, another Easy Robotics plan. And then we've got one last polling question. And the poll is open now. And again, really appreciate you guys today. Appreciate you guys dialing in and hanging out for a little while. I know this went pretty quick, and it's just a brief overview. I think we've got a brief Q&A on the end, but we'd be more than happy to spend time with you guys to learn more about how we can help you and find out if there's a cobot in your future. So thanks so much for joining us today. We'll go ahead and see what the poll results are here. Okay, so a question here would be, what benefit would you hope to achieve with a cobot? And the choices are productivity, free up operators, more important skill tasks. And that's actually one of the eight wastes that was introduced by the Lean organization in just the last couple of years. Deming had always had seven classical wastes that had been around through the Toyota production system for decades. And the eighth one's really great, and it's utilizing the talent and skill of people. And when we have them standing in front of a machine, loading and unloading a part, there's probably more beneficial things that we could find for them to do. So I'm just waiting for those results to come up, and then we'll kind of wrap things up here and move to the Q&A side. All right, so we're seeing poll results now, and maybe you guys can see them. I can't see them on my side, so I apologize for the delay. All right, so 43% look at it for productivity. And I think that's great because it definitely does drive productivity. We've seen that over and over again. 33% free up operators and you know, give them the opportunity to work on more skilled tasks. 10% adding another shift, and 14% learning new technology. So good stuff, and thanks again for participating. Let's see if we can get back on track here. I believe, so that was our last polling question. That's me. And then I think we've got, if we have any questions, I'll pull them up here. Okay. One question here is, how many different parts in the machining cell can be managed with a cobot? So that's a great question. It's one of those questions, probably it depends. If you've got, you know, square parts or arm parts, it just depends on how heavy the parts are, how many parts you're dealing with. But basically, we can use the end of arm tool, the gripper. We can use double or triple end of arm tools. We're usually, just like anything else, if you were taking a family of parts and put them in a cell, we're trying to find that common thread, right? So the common thread might be that they're similar in size, that they're similar in nature to characteristics. So maybe there's one piece that we can hold on. So I apologize if I didn't answer the question, but there are a number of ways to hold different parts, but sometimes they can be apples and oranges. But again, would be happy to dig into things if people had additional questions on that or wanted to dig a little deeper. For some reason, I'm not getting this pop up so I can see all the questions very well. I apologize.
Hey, Jeff, how about I read them out loud to you?
Sure, that'd be great. Thanks, Sarah.
Okay. We have a lot of older equipment. How readily can these be interfaced with 20 to 25 year old machines?
Yeah, that's a great question. So if you look at the application of hard wiring, we're really just working with whatever controls there. So it doesn't really matter so much how old the machine is. If it got beyond, let's say, having some of the IOs that we want, there's ways to work around it. We can tap into the cycle start button. We can have the machine, the cobot press cycle start. We can add PLC. So clearly, the age of the machine doesn't really affect the cobot whatsoever.
Okay. Another question is, how many inputs are on the cobot, digital/analog?
Okay, so there's 16 digital input and output, so 32 total, and there's two analog.
Are there any OSHA or ANSI safeguarding standards? Also, what is the max weight?
Okay, so I'm sure there is. In our handouts, we've loaded in the brochure for the cobots, and it specifies the ICs and the different safeties that we work with. The Doosan cobot is certified. As far as max weight, we've got four versions out currently, four more to join in third quarter, and probably two more at the end of the year. Currently, our max weight payload is M1509, so 15 kilograms. So that'd be just a little north of 30 pounds. And generally, we want to use kind of the 80-20 rule. If you look at that part on the Pearson that we loaded earlier, that was about 22 pounds, and that cobot's, you know, spec'd out for 22 pounds. So they're doing fine with it. But, you know, kind of rule of thumb, let's say Kennametal says run this tool at 1,000 surface feet per minute, you might back it down just a little bit for predictivity. So, again, to answer your question, 15 kilograms is the highest payload right now, and we should be announcing higher payloads before the end of the year.
Okay, and there was a follow-up question to that. Are there safety inputs on the cobot to install laser light curtains?
Sure. So you can install laser light curtains. You can install floor mats. You can use floor scanners. So with those 16 inputs and outputs, that's just a starting point. We can expand that as well. So you can control many, many different things with a cobot and a number of safety devices. Thank you for that question. That's a great question.
Okay, looks like we've got one more question. How many different parts can this cobot load and unload on a machine?
Yeah, so that was the first one I could see. I could only spot that. I'll have to get a little training myself there. But it just depends on the gripper. I think the one that I showed you recently where the tray was on top of the base, that was an example of how they were loading multiple parts. They might have to change their fingers. So if you think of like an M-arm tool, basically the cobot stops at your hand. So then we have the gripper, and then the gripper fingers would be like your chuck jaws. So if you think of the chuck jaws or the vice jaws, and if you can load them into one jaw, then you could probably pick it up with one cobot, right? If you've got to change the jaws out, then you probably have to have a different end of arm or different fingers. And generally fingers are sold as blanks, just like jaws. You can print them. If you've got a 3D printer, you can get them printed online, or you can machine them yourself. So there's a variety of choices there.
Okay, that was the last of the questions.
Well, great. Well, we certainly appreciate you guys at Ellison Technologies. We appreciate the tough times we're going through. I personally appreciate everyone's time today. And if there's anything we can do to help, please don't hesitate to reach out. My email address is there. My email and phone's on LinkedIn, and have a wonderful day. Thanks for your time today.